It is incumbent on us as we regulate to make sure that we provide opportunities for people that have been thrown under the bus by the war on drugs.
Welcome to the Greener Grass podcast from BlueBird Botanicals. I'm your host, Lex Pelger. Kayvan Khalatbari is running for mayor of Denver. From founding Sexy Pizza to his successful decriminalization initiative in 2005, his entrepreneurialism and his activism have already shaped local culture for the better. Now he wants to take things even farther by running for mayor of Denver. Kayvan wants Denver to take advantage of the growing economic opportunities and to mobilize and empower those who have been trampled by the drug war and the extremes of inequality. If you're in Denver and wondering who to vote for in the next election, or if you just want to hear what a powerful and forward-looking electoral candidate sounds like, you'll enjoy this interview with Kayvan Khalatbari. This show is brought to you by BlueBird Botanicals, to spread education about cannabis and other things on the greener side of life. BlueBird CBD oil comes from farms in southern Colorado and is grown using only water, soil, and sunlight. Go to BlueBirdBotanicals.com for more info. Hello, everyone. I'm very pleased to be here with Kayvan, who is running for mayor in Denver in 2019.
Thanks so much for having me.
And before we get to all of your activism and work like this, I want to know a little bit more about growing up in Nebraska.
Yeah, so grew up in Northeast Lincoln, Nebraska, which is pretty middle class, white. I was definitely one of the more of color people, I would say, growing up there. But Lincoln was great. You know, good schools, good environment, very safe. Even though it's Nebraska in general is pretty conservative, Lincoln itself is very liberal. Second or third per capita gay population in the country. It's got 85,000 people in college out of the 300,000 people that live there. A lot of immigrants, which is why my dad moved there. It's an assimilation point for refugees after wars and genocide. So a lot of Asians, a lot of Middle Easterns, a lot of Africans has set up shop in Nebraska. So actually a lot more ethnic food, I think, available in Lincoln than we have out here in Denver. But you know, Lincoln was great. My upbringing was interesting. My dad didn't assimilate, I think, as well as he would have liked, and became addicted to gambling. That put us into bankruptcy twice before I was 10. Led to my parents getting divorced, to us losing our home when I was 10 years old. So after that, my mom, single mom at that point, worked 2 to 3 jobs to keep myself and my younger brother afloat. And I really learned my work ethic from her. I started living on my own at 16 because she ended up getting married and moving to Montana. And since then, I've really just been hustling and working as hard as I can to make a life for myself. I had kind of said to myself that I was going to retire when I was 35 at that point, because I never wanted money to be an issue in my family. And little did I know that I would be not retiring, but moving into this potentially new political career. But I got into cannabis, I think, at a young age, probably around 15 is when I started consuming, to really deal with the things that were happening in life. Working full-time, going to school full-time, dealing with the familial issues, it was a great way to escape. It wasn't until I got older that I really realized that I used it medicinally. You know, I used it for my anxiety and for my depression, for my inability to sleep throughout the evening, to have an appetite because I work so much. And cannabis has just had such an integral part in my life and my upbringing since I started consuming cannabis at 15. It's really been a daily ritual since then. So meant a whole lot to me. It really set the foundation for me understanding that cannabis wasn't as detrimental to people as I think a lot of the scare tactics and DARE programs and things like that might suggest. So when I moved out to Denver and I turned 21 and found a group called Safer, I really wanted to advocate for adults, at least. I don't know if I'd advocate for you know, all kids to be using it. I think it's appropriate in some cases and inappropriate in others. But cannabis is a malleable plant and has a lot of different impacts on people depending on where they're at in their life. And I've certainly seen that throughout the spectrum of my personal use and also my career working in the space.
And so it sounds like you worked really hard at school. You graduated early and then moved out to Denver. And I'm curious what that was like to go from there to here.
It was, you know, it was a little difficult at first. I didn't know anyone out here. I had worked for an engineering firm back in Nebraska that I got a job with immediately out of college. I was 19 when I started working for that firm. And they wanted to open an office here in Denver and expand that. They saw, I think, you know, what we've all seen in Denver the last decade and wanted to prepare for that and saw the building, the construction trades really dramatically increasing here. So I moved out right after I turned 21 and didn't know a soul. And it was actually cannabis that got me integrated into the community here. My brother moved out to Denver after I did, probably about 9 months afterwards, and we lived together. And we were both looking for a way to get involved and to meet new people and to really integrate into the community here. And we had looked at a lot of the standard nonprofits, Habitat for Humanity, Rescue Mission, and none of those really jumped out at us. But my brother got online and had seen this group called SAFER, which was a marijuana policy project initiative. Stood for Safer Alternative for Enjoyable Recreation. And they had just passed initiatives on Colorado and Colorado State campuses that student body vote, largely symbolic, but equalized the penalty of having cannabis on campus with alcohol. Because even though alcohol was obviously more dangerous, it kills 1 in 7 working age Americans. It was driving a lot of the rape culture, the violence, the burning couches after football games, all of that up in Boulder. Cannabis obviously wasn't doing that. They didn't get why people having cannabis on campus led to losing scholarships and housing and leading to some of these very detrimental outcomes for people for choosing to use that safer substance. So we knew that message worked up in Boulder and Fort Collins on campuses, and we brought it down here to Denver with Initiative 100. And I worked on that. That was my first real political activism, my first time integrating into the community here, my first time working on cannabis policy reform. And it was to pass for adults the ability to have an ounce or less in your possession and to not be criminalized. And that passed in 2005.
What was it like to be working on your first campaign like that? What's the nitty-gritty details of doing that kind of work?
You know, I didn't understand it. I had not been I had not been politically active at all, really, in my life. I don't even think I had voted at that time. And it really set in motion for me this idea that if we're going to change laws and make the world a better place, that it's going to happen at the local level. That's where fires start, right? When you look at the civil rights movement, at LGBTQ rights, when you look at cannabis and the path that those took, they started as small fires at the local level that proved concept, that showed the sky's not going to fall if we take this stand. It gets people to buy into these ideas, to have the conversation around these ideas. And then you see other municipalities pick it up. And then you see other states pick it up. And all of a sudden it becomes a federal conversation. And that's exactly what's happening in cannabis right now. So as I look, you know, into the future and all these things we have to fix in this country regarding economic disparity and racial issues, I think we really need to put our foot down at the local level to find some progress on these. But it was very empowering to understand that a ragtag bunch of, folks who were just really loving cannabis and saw the detriment that it was having on our society. At the time, 11,000 people were going to jail every year in Colorado for simple cannabis possession. 800,000 people across this country, creating barriers to housing and employment, child custody, financial aid. We saw that we could change that and have an impact on that conversation locally through this ballot initiative. So very, very empowering to get involved politically at that time and seeing a lot of passion and using evidence and facts and having conversations with people about those can really do to change this world for the better.
And what advice would you have for younger people listening who want to get involved in the political activism?
Yeah, jump in. There are, especially under this administration right now with Donald Trump, there's so many folks that are very upset about him being elected. And, you know, I am too, obviously, to an extent. And he's very dangerous to a lot of certain populations, especially around immigration and some of the folks that deal with decisions that are made at the federal level. But I'm actually very encouraged by Donald Trump becoming president because he's empowered folks locally. He's reminded them that we could lose our freedoms, that we could lose our quality of life any day if we stop paying attention, if we stop participating in politics. And I've seen the amount of groups activists, advocate groups, people being educated on these issues just increased dramatically over the first couple of years of his presidency. And it's really been encouraging to see folks get involved again. So I would say find the issue that you're most passionate about and just start going to some of these meetups, start going to some of the rallies, start going to some of the organizing events that are happening. They're all over the city right now. They're all over the state. And you can find people that feel just as you do on these topics. And once you start making those relationships and getting involved, it's amazing how much all of these things intersect. And all, you know, you're concerned about police violence. Now all of a sudden you're working on criminal justice and drug policy reform and housing issues and bond reform. And it just keeps growing because all these issues are intersecting. But all it takes is really getting involved and being a participant, and you never know what it leads to. That's how I've lived my life. I've gotten involved in so many things without having expectations, without knowing where it's going to lead. But once you get involved in these with these people that are so passionate about these topics, it's amazing where it'll take you.
And what's really intriguing to me is as you're starting this political activism career, you're also starting to become an entrepreneur at the same time with Sexy Pizza.
Yeah, Sexy Pizza is my first business. It's 10 and a half years old now. And I actually started it with one of the gentlemen who started Safer here in Denver, and then the first employee of Safer. And they were from Long Island, New York, and always wanted to open a pizzeria, always wanted to call it Sexy Pizza. I was getting so sick of my engineering job at the time. I was in a gray cubicle in a gray office with people that I felt were kind of gray inside, and saw my ceiling in that firm because I didn't have my professional engineering degree. I just had an associate's degree. Even though I was working harder and doing a lot more than many in that office, they put this arbitrary limit on me, and I just didn't think that was right. So I walked in one morning and put in my 2 weeks notice, and they told me I could leave immediately. And without knowing I was going to be out of a job that day, when I woke up, here I was without one, and ended up exhausting my savings, my 401k, my IRA. I borrowed as much as I could from family and friends, maxed out credit cards to buy a failing pizzeria in Capitol Hill that we had found out about. Never made a pizza, never ran a business, but took that plunge and took that risk. And you can't accomplish the things that you want in life. I don't think you can be truly happy unless you're taking risks and you're actually striving for, without failure, what you want to achieve in life. And we ended up buying this place, made all our mistakes under their name. Once we felt good about where we were at with the recipes and what we wanted to do with the interior, we remodeled, we changed the name, we changed the menu, and we opened as Sexy Pizza. But a hell of an experience for a first-time entrepreneur that ultimately led to me starting Denver Relief 9 months later, which we started with $4,000 and half a pound of cannabis after Obama was elected. And he said he wasn't going to use federal resources going after state-compliant businesses. So that was my entry into the regulated cannabis industry after being involved in policy for so long.
I didn't realize that it was only a nine-month gap. So the pizza hadn't had time to really solidify as something that was going to float you, and you're jumping into the next project.
Yeah, and that, you know, pizza was never really my aspiration. It wasn't something that I wanted to do long term. It was something that my friends wanted to do, and I wanted to help them get there. We all had complementary skills and used that to our benefit in starting this place. But I ultimately wanted to do something bigger, and I wanted to continue that role as an advocate. And I felt that one of the best ways to do that was to start a cannabis business when there were so many folks that were bad actors, bad players, bad examples for this industry involved in it, to make sure that people knew that cannabis is a plant for good, and that a lot of the people that were running these businesses that were advocating for patients at the time were really good people, really well-intending people. And we wanted to make sure that that was the narrative that got perpetuated in the media. As Colorado built this industry, really was the inception of the regulated cannabis industry, we always wanted to make sure that people knew that you could start a business, that we could make profit, that we could run a good business, but that we could also be good stewards of our community, of our environment, of empowering the folks that have been harmed by the war on drugs up to that point. So Denver Relief and other companies that were like us really bonded on a lot of those issues, and I think were really instrumental in starting a lot of the foundation of the regulated industry, heading in the right direction, and making sure that some of those voices that were less than ideal for us got drowned out in some of the media coverage that was there in the early years.
And something I like about both these projects, Sexy Pizza has a great thing still going on where the money gets returned for certain pizzas to charitable organizations like SSDP and other groups that we believe in. And it sounds like the same thing was going with Denver Relief as well, a place to prove the social justice side was possible. How did you start off implementing that? What was the process?
Well, we knew that it would be very difficult for us to get traction in our communities and to be accepted as this new business that was still not regulated at the state level, still not regulated at the city level. Even before we got community buy-in, we had to get buy-in from landlords, right? And these building owners that were very untrusting of this industry. When we applied for our space at One Broadway, which ultimately became our location for Denver Relief, I think there were 20 other people that had applied for that spot. And to set ourselves apart, to differentiate ourselves, we created a full business plan. And in within that business plan was this this desire to be stewards of our community. And my partner Ian Sieb at the time, still my partner in Denver Relief Consulting, ended up starting the Green Team. And the Green Team was just a collaborative effort amongst cannabis businesses, non-cannabis businesses, consumers of cannabis, to band together and to do community impact projects. So we started cleaning up trash after the 420 rally at Civic Center Park because it was such a mess afterwards. And we felt that that was such a negative perception for the cannabis industry that we decided to take 50 volunteers down there all in our Green Team shirts and our compostable bags. And we picked up all that trash. And that grew into urban gardening initiatives with Ecar Farms. I think we harvested and donated 18,000 pounds of organic vegetables last year to food banks, food pantries, free bicycle wheelchair repair clinics, college scholarships for underserved youth, really just creating community around the cannabis industry. Even if we weren't doing something good for our neighbors, we were bringing folks together in the cannabis industry that just wanted to know that there were folks like them out there that were well-intending, that were, I hate the word, but quote-unquote normal, that just wanted to see this industry be not just another one, but a better one, and to rally around that idea and to work together to achieve that. But the Green Team was really that effort, which is still alive today, has mobilized thousands of volunteers and hundreds of businesses in this really collaborative spirit to want to make the industry be something special.
The business itself must have been doing quite well because it was the longest running in Denver history until a sale to Willie Nelson, correct?
That's correct. We sold it in 2016. And from what we can tell, and granted records are a little bit scant early on in the industry, we believe that at the time of the sale, we were the longest continuously operating cannabis business with common ownership in the state of Colorado, which is a testament to all of us working together, which is amazing because the two partners that I started that with, I had only known for a few weeks prior to starting Denver Relief. We really took a chance. Very different people, different ideas about a lot of things in life, but ultimately after the same goal, to create a successful business and to integrate into our communities and create a great industry. So it worked out really well. But it was sad to leave it behind, but I think we saw the writing on the wall with us being a small operator. You know, there's so many small operators in Colorado that are really burdened right now by this consolidation that's happening in the industry. The prices are hitting the floor. There's so much product out there. There's so many licenses that we felt that our efforts, our time was best spent in helping others achieve what we did with Denver Relief. So a couple years prior, we started Denver Relief Consulting, which ended up helping folks start businesses in 13 different states, Puerto Rico, Canada, DC. We've worked for federal governments across the globe on understanding what regulated cannabis means, not just for business owners, but for government and for communities. And we felt that that was a great way to continue our advocacy. So after we sold, we really put the pedal down on our advocacy through our consulting work. And it's been a great thing for us.
Working with the zaniness of all these different state laws, which can be somewhat arbitrary, if you were crafting regulations for the state, a state, what are some of those important lines in the sand that you would draw around the regulation of cannabis?
You know, we can't, as we're seeing on a lot of East Coast states, have so limited licenses available that people can't participate. I would like to see a more open system similar to Colorado. But if we're going to have a free market like this that allows for the consolidation that's happening right here in Colorado, we need to allow for smaller entrepreneurs to get in and to be successful in some capacity. I'm a huge fan of collective models in business in general. I'd love to see those ushered in into Colorado. That gives more people the opportunity to participate, to have ownership in the cannabis industry. I think that's really important. I think we need to, no matter what happens with regard to local, state, and federal policy reform on this topic, we must maintain the right for adults to grow at their home. Just as people can brew beer at their house, there should be no reason why we should ever get that right taken from us at any level of government. And I'm going to fight to definitely make sure that that happens. But then lastly, I think we need to be really considerate of the war on drugs, and that this is the start of the fall of that wall, and that it is incumbent on us as we regulate to make sure that we provide opportunities for people that have been thrown under the bus by the war on drugs. These communities that have been harmed dramatically over the last several decades by this war on drugs have been predominantly poor people, predominantly people of color. And those people are not finding opportunities, not just in ownership, but in employment because of past criminal records. We need to expunge all of these nonviolent drug offenses that are on people's records when we legalize cannabis. And we need to make sure that the tax money's collected, you know, $250 million plus here in Colorado today, that a good portion of this gets spent reinvesting in these communities that have been harmed by the war on drugs, by giving them back their agency, by finding ways for them to be not just having ownership in the cannabis industry, but be able to start small businesses, to go back to school, to really reinvest in these people and make sure that we can undo some of this harm that's been placed on them over the years. And I guess so more broadly, I'd love to see the overregulation of the cannabis industry stop. It's amazing that alcohol kills 1 in 7 working age Americans, and that it's held to such a lower standard than cannabis with regard to how it's regulated, how it's made available to consumers. We need to make sure that cannabis is held to a standard similar, that we're not over-regulating, because we understand that it's much safer, that it doesn't have the detrimental impact on our communities. And we need to make sure that the access is as easy as it is for alcohol, to give people that safer choice, because they will move in that direction, right? My favorite stat outside of teen use going down since legalization here in Colorado is that alcohol consumption amongst 18 to 35 year olds is down while their cannabis consumption's gone up. People are choosing, when they have that option, the safer choice. And we need to make, in line with that, social use establishments available. And until we can go out as adults and enjoy cannabis in a social environment similar to alcohol, that we have not realized the intent of Amendment 64. We have not realized all the way back to when we decrimmed in 2005 what people set out to do, which is put these on a level playing field. And we need to have social use establishments available for adults to participate in cannabis consumption in a safe, secure place, supervised, regulated place, not just for tourists, but for the people that live in Denver, that live in HOA or landlord-controlled apartments that now preclude you from having it in your lease, for folks that live in federally subsidized properties, veterans especially, that can't consume legally in their home, or for people that simply don't want to consume at home around their kids. And we need to give them an outlet to do that in the public space.
And so as you run for mayor and hold positions like this, I assume the cannabis thing might be more accepted in this state, but being so against the war on drugs, how much pushback do you receive when you're out in the community talking about these issues?
I think people are starting to get it. I think cannabis opened up that conversation for folks, and they said, yeah, why are we sending folks to jail for matters of public health, right? If somebody is dealing with addiction, and I'm not talking about necessarily cannabis, but harder drugs, the best bet is not to throw them in jail and create these barriers to future opportunities in life. You've put shame and stigma, you've applied that to them to the extent that they're never going to find their own opportunities in life again because of these criminal records. Even after you've served your time, these records stay there in perpetuity and preclude you from these fair opportunities ongoing. If we're talking about addiction to drugs, if we're talking about sex work, if we're talking about homelessness, if we're talking about mental health issues, these are best treated and we can best find resolve on them through services. And all of a sudden, Portugal decriminalizes and all drugs are decriminalized in small amounts for possession because they realize it's a public health matter. They start having a conversation about being a public health matter. The dollars spent on services match that conversation. And all of a sudden, drugs go from the number two issue that the citizens have to, like, not even in the top 20. Because they're actually dealing with it in a productive manner. Our services are best given to people, provided to people outside of jail. We're going to provide them to them anyways in jail. They're less effective. They're more costly in jail. To subsidize somebody's housing is one third the cost than it is to incarcerate them. You know, why are we not providing folks this opportunity to get better instead of going to jail? People don't use drugs, or they're not homeless, or they're not dealing with mental health issues, or they're not engaged in sex work because they're bad people. They're doing those things to survive or to deal with some sort of trauma in their life. And until we get to the root of those issues and start solving those issues with them collaboratively, we're just going to make it worse. And our current war on drugs is simply digging arbitrary holes for people that we're throwing folks in. And then we're putting our head down on their foot and really disallowing them from getting out. And we need to change that dynamic. That's a systemic thing that I think we can have a big piece of furthering here in Denver and a lot of local municipalities like Berkeley and Oakland and LA that are really pushing in a more progressive direction.
To back up a little bit, what was it that made you want to run for mayor?
You know, I ran for city council 3 years ago because I saw that we were not having conversations about the things that Denver was dealing with as far as issues in the city. The number one issue on people's minds right now and in their lives is housing. You know, more than half the folks living in the city that rent are rent burdened, cost burdened, meaning they spend more than a third of their income on housing. More than 25% spend more than 50% of their income on housing. And we're still not seeing a meaningful response to those statistics from our current administration. This was an issue back in 2015 when I ran for city council. And it started as a joke run for mayor, and I just wanted to initiate those conversations. But I ended up running for city council because I thought I could have more of a voice. But at the end of the day, nobody viable ran for mayor in 2015. Therefore, this current mayor did not debate. There was no dialogue. We didn't talk at all about these issues that have now grown exponentially in the last 3 years. So when I was seeing this next 2019 election come up, I didn't see conversations happening again. I didn't see any viable candidates get ready to stand up and challenge this current administration on these failed policies to try to fix this housing issue. So that was my main, desire to get in, was to make sure that we are having dialogue, not just around housing, but around environment. We're the 11th most polluted city in America in Denver. We're investing all of our transportation infrastructure in widening and burying an interstate through the poorest neighborhood in Denver instead of investing in public transportation. We spent more on deputy overtime in our jails last year than we did on affordable housing. We spent more on an LED sign at the airport last year than we did on affordable housing. And our priorities are backwards. And until we start having conversations and shining light on these issues for Denver residents, I don't think that we're going to be able to change them. And I believe that people in my position, folks who, I haven't always been privileged. I was homeless 10 years ago for 9 months here in Denver. But now I employ 400 people in 13 companies in 8 states. I owe it to the city that gave me those opportunities to step out and to use my privilege to benefit these conversations and to benefit the people that don't have voices for themselves, to empower them in this political process. And that's why I stepped in. Little did I know that we'd gain the traction that we have, right? Our most recent polling shows that 63% of Denverites are ready for a change at the mayor spot. I led that polling that we got done 2 weeks ago, 52 to 44. We're keeping pace with an incumbent mayor in fundraising, and we have about 350 volunteers already registered with the campaign. We started knocking doors a month and a half ago. People are ready for a change. The majority of Denver voters under 40 are unaffiliated. I'm unaffiliated because neither of the parties speak to me. They may have some values that resonate with me, but their actions do not. And I think until we have more unaffiliated people of party that are willing to pursue good policy and things that are good for people and for our communities, that we're not going to change that. But I think Denver's headed in that direction. That's what people want to see. So this campaign, those polling numbers were with likely voters, but this campaign is going to go out to reach out to the folks that are less than likely to vote in a municipal election and get them on board, right? Young people, creatives, folks in the tech space, folks in the cannabis industry. We need to get these people out to the polls, because if we do, we're going to see what's happening across the country, which are a lot of these progressive candidates, these forward-thinking candidates that care more about equity than simply profiteering, winning elections and actually changing the fabric of our communities and how we operate, how we integrate government into society, and how people engage government and hold them accountable to an equitable society.
The last question before I let you get back to work. If you do get in that mayor's seat, what are the first things that you would want to get done?
We have to open up the doors, and we have to be more transparent. We have to be honest about the problems that we're facing. We, as a city, our current administration lies about the severity of some of the issues that we're dealing with. We don't solicit community input. If we do, it's done as an aesthetic. It's not because we actually want to absorb these folks' input. We need to bring community back to the table in the decision-making process. So I think precluding that from happening right now are certain people at the top that run certain departments, divisions that we need to get rid of because we need to recreate the culture in government. We need to let the people of Denver know that this government's working for them and that we're going to do it collaboratively in solving the issues that Denver's facing. So we have some environmental issues, some cultural issues within our city that we need to deal with, and that starts at the top. We need good leadership that puts people in a position to be empowered to create these cultures that we want to see that are collaborative, that are based in evidence and science and how we solve problems, not based in theory or past policy pursuits that maybe worked 30 or 40 years ago, but don't today in this quickly changing world. I think we need to have a conversation about how severe these issues are and how we can tackle them together. That's step one. But on some of the larger issues, I want to start to see how we can charter a public bank here in Denver to save taxpayers $100 million a year in revenue that's now currently being shipped out of the state to Wall Street banks because of money mismanagement. I want to see the Office of Economic Development move towards supporting small businesses, collective models, employee-owned models, as opposed to continually deferring all of our incentives and our resources to encouraging big companies to move their headquarters here. I want to see us support diversion programs in our jails to try to get these folks that are engaging in drug use and sex work and homelessness and mental health to divert them away from prison as quickly as possible and to start those conversations. And I believe that for less money than we spent on deputy overtime last year in our jails, that we can send every single DPS graduate that qualifies for free and reduced lunch to college or to a skilled trade program, an apprenticeship program to feed into this glut, this need that we're going to have in the construction trade in Colorado here in the next couple of years. We're going to be 95,000 construction jobs short in the state in 2025. We need to be diverting as many people from jail into those opportunities and give them agency to control their own lives through those jobs, those good paying jobs with benefits, and do the same with those college kids that are, or those high school kids that are graduating that aren't going to college, and make sure that they can take care of themselves and don't become a financial burden on us as taxpayers in perpetuity. But these are going to be long haul projects, right? But we have to start those conversations on day one and start to be honest about our problems and what we want to do to address them and to do it collaboratively. And that's the spirit we're going to try to create out the gate.
Well, thank you so much. It's a grand vision, and best of luck in the campaign.
Thank you so much for having me. And if folks want to learn more about me, they can go to my website, kayvanfordenver.com. It's kayvanfordenver.com. We're looking for volunteers in many ways that fit people's lives. And we're obviously looking to continue the fundraising train. Even $5, $10, $15, $25 a month recurring donation helps out dramatically. I also hope that if people have questions or they have things they want to share with how they think Denver can be better, that they'll reach out. I'm an accessible candidate. We're an accessible campaign, and we're here to listen.
Great. Thanks so much.
Thanks, Lex.
Greener Grass is a BlueBird Botanicals podcast. Their CBD oil supports a healthy body and a strong endocannabinoid system. They've got friendly customer service who can answer any of your questions, and the number is right there at the top of their webpage. But per the FDA, they won't be able to make any medical claims for these nutritional supplements. That's also the reason you'll hear little about CBD on this show. There's no need for us to add more evidence about CBD when a simple Google search will give you more than you can read in a month of Sundays. So this show covers the cannabis world and more with editorial freedom from BlueBird Botanicals. Thanks for joining the Greener Grass podcast. As always, our audio alchemist is Matt Payne. The Gypsy Jazz theme music comes from Brett Van Donsel. Our beautiful bird sounds are courtesy of Lang Elliott. And I'm your host, Lex Pelger, wishing you a bright green day.